Welcome. Thank you for tuning in to our Struggles of the Spirit program. Those of you who have seen it before know a lot of the kind of work that we try to do, and it's an hour's program. Normally, it is a phone-in program. Today, unfortunately, we can't be live, and so therefore we can't receive your direct phone calls. However, this is the main offering that we are giving you for this week, beginning on October the 10th. And so we'd like you to respond by other means, by phoning the studio, the Adelphia Cable Studio here in South Burlington, and giving them your feedback for the Struggles of the Spirit program, or writing us, care of the studio. Give us your name and address, phone number, and if we receive anything from you, we'll write you back or phone you back, as it may work out. We are delighted for your input and your interest, so please don't worry about how expert you are on the subject we're looking at. We just want your interest, your input, and so what we are doing this day, now the October the 10th, we're continuing a series of investigations into the whole world of the Mideast and of the Muslim world. It's a world we don't know much about, and it's a very rich, wonderful, talented, gifted world that we Westerners have been somewhat blinded to. And the tragedy on September 11th has made us become aware that we better learn something about the culture we're dealing with, that we only have misconceptions by and large, and we need to be enlightened. And so I'm offering here through Adelphia Cable input about what are Muslims like, and what is their world like, and where have they been all these years. And to try to help us do that today, I have a professor of history,
yes,
who's here. He's at the University of Vermont, and his name is Bogac Ergene, and he volunteered to be with us today and to talk about the Muslim world from the historical point of view. Mm-hmm. I'm not asking you to explain why somebody would do something that's violent as
yes,
killing thousands of people. I mean, that's something only we can ask God about someday.
Mm-hmm.
But only God knows, ultimately. We can guess, but
right,
but only God knows. But I'd like you to educate us about from the historical point of view, mm-hmm, about the Muslim world. And I guess I'd like to give you just a free hand. You're a professor of history, so you're used to having a free hand, and I will ask you questions from time to time and mm-hmm, ask for clarification. And
right.
So I'll just hand the program over to you.
Thank you so much for
yes,
having me here. And when we think about the Middle East, when we think about the Muslim people, first of all, we have to make a distinction between the Middle East and the Muslim people.
Okay.
Although the majority of the Muslims on the world today live in the Middle East, there are sizable population minorities of other religions, including Christianity, and which is really sad today. In sense of what's going on in the United States is discrimination. When people are discriminating against the Middle East people in the United States, they are usually discriminating against Christians in the United States, and which is all on the one hand indicating the ignorance towards, you know, this particular people, this particular culture in the United States. And on the other hand, you know, alienating these people from their own cause, because these people are here in the United States because of their own problems in the Middle East. They run away from certain pressures from the Middle East, and they want to establish a new kind of lifestyle here.
Oh,
which
you,
is
you mean the people who are citizens or want to be citizens?
Exactly, exactly.
They're here to find a new culture, a new country.
Exactly,
mm-hmm,
and that's that's why they are living a double torture in a sense. They all, on the one hand, mm-hmm. suffer from this attack, what happened on September 11th, and on the other hand, they feel alienated in the community, in the society that in which they would like to, you know,
to be brothers and sisters.
Exactly, to live, to have a future together with other people. About Middle East, when we think about the Middle East, when we think about peoples and cultures there, the first thing that should come to our mind is, you know, we are not looking at a monolithic phenomena. We are looking at a variety of different, very different, and almost contradictory issues and cultures and people here.
That's helpful. It's not a simplistic
definitely
way to sum it all up.
Right, and we are looking at something. If we want to inquire our investigation on Islam through history, we have to be aware of the fact that you know, Islam has evolved and transformed over time, and has a potential to transform, further evolve, and further transform. And it's open to political pressures. You know, it's Islam, and what people understand from Islam in the Middle East context is very related to political situation in the Middle East in the time that they are living. So there is no one above and beyond category as Islam. When we are talking about Muslim people especially, or Muslim cultures, we cannot alienate these people, isolate these people and their cultures from what's going on in their own times and societies.
So
what I'm trying to say is that, you know, it's not Muslims who, for example, committed these atrocities or these murders. It's Muslims who lived, who experienced certain kind of experiences, and who suffered from certain kind of political pressures and oppressions, who committed those murders. We have to understand them in their own historical contexts, in a sense. It's not their worldview, it's not their religious ideology, it's not a specific kind of theology which made them to act in the ways that they acted, for example, in those four plains on September 11th. But it's that political background, it's that history that they are coming from, is very much responsible.
May I just interrupt you?
Sure.
And sort of reinforce what you're saying, that I believe it was the year 1920 in this country that women were given the right to vote,
right,
and to hold, I believe, property in their name. And even though this was a Christian country, someone looking in from Mars or some,
right,
some other place might say, well, Christians don't honor women at all.
Exactly.
They can't even vote. They're like a servant, and what a terrible religion with an attitude like that. And then suddenly,
right,
it's all changed.
Right. That's absolutely my point. It's a very good example in that sense. So it's very easy for us to say Muslims are this, Arabs are that, but you know, just to be a better human being means that, you know, we pass beyond those kind of objectifications, to pass beyond those kind of simplistic attitudes towards those people we don't know about, we don't necessarily understand. There was no, for example, protest in this country when United States was bombing places in the Middle East in 1990s. Although those were very painful experiences for the people in that particular period. But, you know, just now this is happening. There is no way to, you know, excuse those kind of the bombings happened, the attacks happened on September 11th. But, you know, we try to empathize with those people, although maybe those may be murderers, and try to understand where they are coming from, and how their brains were washed, and why it was so easy to brainwash them in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just why was it so easy for them, or to push them to commit these kind of atrocities, these kind of murders. That's what needs to be understood in this country.
I heard on the television it sounded like a good program, I can believe it. They were asking a few psychiatrists, were these people who were orchestrating the,
right,
the crash, were they psychotic? Were they out of their minds? Were they completely crazy?
Mm-hmm.
And all of them said no. They weren't.
Right.
They were determined. They were convinced that was the thing to do. But they weren't nuts.
Right.
They weren't.
Right. No, you're absolutely right about that. The problem is that, you know, in the United States, and I see this among my students is too, that, you know, they are so easy to categorize different people according to their culture. They are, you know, putting everything that they don't really understand under the title of other. If they are not with us, if they are not from our side of the society, our side of the world, they are with the other culture, you know, just, and that's what's happening with the sex too, you know, just those people are very different, you know, those people who are called people with the diapers on their heads by congressmen and senatemen on radios and television. Those people, Hindus and Sikhs, because they are, they seem
diapers
like...
Diapers on their head?
That's what they are called by a Republican congressman, actually.
Actually?
That's really sad.
How insulting.
It's insulting, and more than that, it's ignorant. Because those people are very different from anything we encounter in the Middle East.
Of course.
And they are very different from Muslims. Not that
Muslims Sikhs with Muslims.
Right, and it's bad for their policies too. You know, if you are going to interrogate a Sikh, pull apart a Sikh person in an airport and interrogate them, that means that you are channeling your sources to a wrong kind of target. You know, you are not dealing with the Middle East people. You are totally confused, and you don't know what to do. You don't know anything about your enemy in that sense. And it's really absurd things are being said and things going on. We were talking about this with you before. People are talking about experts, so-called experts, and places like PBS talking about the necessity of racial profiling on television. And you know, I can't believe this is happening. I really can't believe this is happening.
Uneducated, stupid people.
You're absolutely right, and there is no easy way to handle to deal with this kind of ignorance too. You know, it's easy to say that we should educate ourselves about other cultures, about other people, about other places, but you know, where are we going to get this education? Of course, from universities, but you know, we have to get other kind of more basic kind of education from, you know, lower basis of our educational institutions, from, you know, the middle schools, high schools, or even primary schools. You know, we should make our children more open to and more capable of identifying the differences between other people, among other people, other than ourselves. This is not what's happening. It's so easy for them to confuse a Sikh with a Muslim, and which is a bad thing, which is a representation of example of sheer ignorance.
Diapers on their head,
right?
Okay.
Yeah, it's shocking. And another thing that I have to emphasize is that many people in the Middle East, the place that I'm coming from, are very upset about the situation. They are very upset about the situation. Many people, at least, because they think that they know that, as Muslims, people in the United States, people in the West will be very, it will be very easy for the people in the United States and the West to identify them with terrorists, quote unquote. You know, they know that they will be persecuted. They know that they will be racially profiled. I'm talking about people from the Middle East, the place that I'm coming from now. And this is really making them really upset about the situation, further upset about the situation. And
I'm not fully understanding.
No, I was talking about the people of the place, people of the region that I'm coming from, the Middle
East. From your home.
Right. And they're upset about the situation, not only because, you know, thousands of people were killed, murdered by these terrorist attacks, but also because they know that their reputation, their identity, their culture will be tarnished in this country as a consequence of these attacks too. They will be, you know, these Muslims living in my own country, for example, Turkey, know that, you know, there will be people in the States, people in the Western world, their understanding of Islam will be, you know, be more negative after this point in the future. And so the most important, and we can be absolutely sure about this situation, about this, that everything has changed at this point. You know, our understanding of Middle East people has changed. It's very difficult now to convince those people who are living in the United States to make them believe once again that there are nice people in the Middle East. And it's just, I've been seeing this among my students, and I'm really, you know, trying hard to show them different faces of Islam. I am teaching Middle East history, I'm teaching Islamic history, trying to show them Islam is not Osama bin Laden, For example, Islam is not only Hezbollah or Jihad or, you know, Taliban, etc. There are different faces of Islam, and those faces are really, you know, it's important for us to be aware of these different faces, more peaceful faces, more, you know, inclusive faces in a sense. And that's what's changed in this country. Now it's very difficult for me to teach other faces about Islam. People will take my class and then they will want to learn about jihad. They will want to learn about the Israeli-Palestinian struggle now, which I am not necessarily interested in myself, because, you know, that's not only, that doesn't represent what's going on in the Middle East now. It's a part of it. It's the part of the Middle East, what's going on, the current situation in the Middle East, but it's not only it, you know. There are other factors. There are other issues going on. There are other problems. For example, in Egypt, there is a problem of female circumcision, female genital mutilation. Yeah. Nobody knows about it. And we people here need to talk about those kind of issues. For example, the civil war between Turkey and between Turks and Kurds. Not many people are aware of that situation. So many other issues that we should be focusing on. And people here in this country do not seem to be aware of the fact that, you know, there is something really wrong about the American foreign policy in the Middle East. We have been talking about war, we have been talking about going to Afghanistan and bombing everywhere there, you know, turning that country to a Stone Age country in a sense. But nobody is considering about the possibility of changing the strategic aims of American foreign policy in the Middle East. Nobody seems to understand that
there's the big problem.
That's the big problem, and that is what's responsible for, in the long run, for this bombing on September 11th, and for future bombings, for future attacks in the future. That's what's really alienated American policy in the Middle East, is responsible for alienating people in the Middle East and making them enemies of the United States.
Would you, since you are a professor of history, would you give people some data about American foreign policy in the Middle East? This is not the Middle East, but I remember when I learned in school years ago that England went to war with China because they wouldn't buy the opium.
Yeah.
I mean,
right.
I mean, I couldn't believe it.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Christian country of England was trying to make money off of the Chinese by selling them opium, which they knew was not going to help their health at all.
Yeah.
I mean, give us some examples.
It's a continuation of the Cold War situation in the Middle East, although the enemy of the United States and Western world changed. It's not Soviet Union anymore.
Is colonialism?
No, Cold War. No, I'm talking about the recent American foreign policy in the Middle East in the 80s and 90s.
Mm-hmm.
Although the enemy has changed in the Middle East in terms of, you know, what United States regarded as being its enemy or not. It's a kind of, you know, United States regards certain countries, certain powers as, you know, hostile governments, and certain other countries as their, you know, their strategic allies, like Turkey is one of these allies, Israel is another, you know, strong ally of the United States. And United States really acts like a partisan power in the Middle East, you know, takes very open sides with countries like Israel and Turkey, which do not have really great friends in the Middle East. And that's why United States is gaining so many enemies in the Middle East. And, you know, just
because
it's so openly siding with Israel and Turkey, it's because Israel is essentially an unjust state, because, you know, what's going on in Palestine is not right. Mm. And people have been suffering the consequences of what's going on in Palestine. And when they see that United States is backing Israel and, you know, providing all kind of financial and military support to a country like Israel, they understandably, you know, do not develop very friendly relations, friendly feelings towards the United States.
When Mr. Bush was running for president, he made a public statement that I heard very loud and clear. He said, "I stand with Israel."
Right.
He didn't say, "I stand with both Israel and the Palestinians,
right,
and I want peace between them."
Right.
He didn't say that. He
right.
just said he stood with Israel, and that if I were a Palestinian.
You will be very upset about that statement. And you know, United States is siding with a country whose Prime Minister Ariel Sharon is responsible for the massacres of Palestinian camps in Lebanon, Sabra and Shatila. This is, you know, a fact actually proven by independent investigation and consuls and courts in Europe. It's personally responsible for the killing of 1,800 men, women, and children in Lebanon in 1982, September 16. This person now is the Prime Minister of Israel. And, you know, when Palestinians, Arabs, see that United States is backing a power whose Prime Minister is Ariel Sharon, you know, you can imagine how they feel about United States. On the other hand, United States represents something other, something different from Arab people, for the Muslims, because it's possible for them still to come to this country and to begin a life from the very scratch, from the very beginning, and be successful.
Yes, it's true.
Live in a comfortable way, in more comfortable way than they could ever imagine in their own country. So there's a conflict of all these feelings towards the United States. You know, in political terms, they feel, they sense hostility. In social and economic terms, it's a land of hope. It's a land of ideal lifestyle, in a sense. It's a land in which they can be live. They can live their lives without being bothered by government, by, you know, legal or illegal institutions. They can live the life that they would like to live. But recently, recently, because of all these recent developments in Palestine, the increasing hostility between Palestinian people and Israel, that negative feelings toward the United States and its policies has been increasing. And that's a fact. And when we saw people on television, Palestinians dancing, we have to think about, the fact that these people, many of them at least, consider the United States as the prime supporter, the most important supporter of a country which killed them in thousands, which exposed them, you know, which made them live in camps in the West Bank and Gaza, you know, in incredibly bad living conditions, and in which, you know, this country made them live in a situation that their children do not have any kind of future prospect, any kind of hope for their future, other than being a martyr by exploding himself and tens of others, you know, in a bazaar or in a coffee shop or something like that. You know, we have to try to empathize that. It's, you know, one of the major good things about religions like Christianity and Islam is that, you know, the ability to empathize with, and you know, to try to feel the feelings of other people.
Islam does empathize.
Yes, of course. Is to try to understand what's going on, tries to understand what they are feeling and the reasons of it. And it's a responsibility of the people of this country, United States, to try to do that, you know, instead of being angry, instead of being, you know, just, a friend of mine told me that, you know, just when he saw those images on television, the Palestinian people cheering, he felt offended. But I told him, it's easy to get offended. Did you try to understand why they are doing this?
Yeah.
Did you know the history behind this, you know, cheering behind these celebrations?
They weren't cheering for the horror and the pain and the death.
Exactly.
They weren't cheering about that.
They were cheering about the fact that they saw, or what they saw, they interpreted as the fall of the Goliath.
Yes.
That the most important power on this part, the most powerful force on the world, could be harmed in a certain way, although in a very unjust, through unjust means, through very horrible means. They realized that that could be done. And they were happy about the fact that, you know, someone from them, someone who could speak Arabic, someone who shared their identity with, culture with, could do this. Mm-hmm. You know, this is a people, when we are thinking about these people, we have to realize that these are people who have been defeated over and over and over and over again in the modern history of the Middle East. They have been defeated by everybody, by the Israelis. They don't have any confidence in themselves that they could do something this magnificent. Magnificent, I'm using in quotation marks. It's a horrible thing, but it has a big impact.
And some of the Palestinians are Christian too.
Yeah,
they're being treated the same way as the
most important Palestinian advocate in this country, United States, Edward Said himself, is Christian, and just he's Christian, but he has been always with, until very recent times, he has been a spokesperson of PLO. That, you know, Palestinians do not make that difference. Many of them, at least, with the exception of Hezbollah and Islamic Jihad, they don't, especially PLO, do not make the difference, between Christians and Muslims, or Shiites, or Druze, or whatever. Yeah.
I think many Americans don't believe in the inequities and the injustice that you recount. They don't believe it happened or could have happened, and
right.
That is just a biased point of view.
Right. Right. There's this naivety, and I'm not saying this with contempt or anything. I find naivety can be really innocent, you know, a sign of innocence in a sense. I find this, I see this in my among my students. I on the one hand, I'm happy for them because they are naive. They are not aware of what's going on, you know, in terms mm-hmm. of injustice mm-hmm. and, you know, terror and pain in other parts of the world. But at the same time, it has negative consequences, and these consequences come to the surface in this kind of questions. One of my students told me, we are nice people. We Americans are nice people. So, you know, why are these people, other people doing this to us? That's the naivety that I'm talking about. You know, just these people are not aware of the fact that, you know, during the Gulf War in Baghdad, according to conservative estimates, about 100,000 civilians were killed. I'm talking about civilians. They are not aware of that fact. And, you know, President Bush described the attacks, the Twin Towers, as covert acts. They were not covert acts. Covert acts as, you know, bombing a town from 32,000 feet above, and, you know, after leaving your bombs there and going back to your bases without getting any harm, these people on the planes, on the airplanes, on the other hand, sacrificed themselves. Regardless of, in the name of what they did this, regardless of the fact that what they did was horrible and disgusting, they were not cowards. American people do not seem, many American people, let me say, many of them, not all of them, seem not to be aware of that fact. They don't know about what happened in Baghdad, for example. And they are not aware of the fact that during the Gulf War, American administration explicitly identified Saddam, and, you know, not only satanized him, he's an evil person, but what American government did was to identify Saddam with the people of Iraq, which is a bad thing, which is an evil thing to do on the part of Americans.
Mm-hmm.
It was so easy to consider, to regard Saddam, to regard the population of Iraq, or, you know, a 30 million Saddams, and it was okay for them to bomb each and every one of them. Nobody seemed to have thought about this before, you know, and it's really angering me to see that kind of reaction, to say on the part of, you know, by the Americans, to say that we did not do anything bad to these people.
When people get involved in war, it's horrendous. I had a friend who was a native German,
right.
And lived in Germany during all of Adolf Hitler's time,
right.
and his defeat. And they said when the American bombers came over, generally the American bombers dropped bombs just on military places and factories,
yeah.
That were making arms, but would not bomb hospitals, would not bomb residential areas.
Mm-hmm.
However, when the British came over, that's where they liked to go,
mm-hmm.
to drop the bombs mm-hmm. on the residential areas and the hospitals. And of course, their excuse, I'm sure, would have been, well, the Battle of England, the Blitz,
right.
They were falling everywhere, the German bombs,
right.
On hospitals and on residential areas. So now you're going to get some of the same. So the English ethic there,
right.
Was an eye for an eye.
Right.
It was not...
Which is the worst thing to do when you are dealing with terrorism, because
yeah.
That will create only more quote-unquote terrorists.
Yeah.
The most smart thing to do for the on the part of the Americans now, United States government, is that try to alienate the followers of people like Osama bin Laden from Osama bin Laden himself. If you go and bomb Afghanistan or Iraq, for that sense, there will be more terrorists, quote-unquote. There will be more people who will be willing to sacrifice their lives.
Would you state that again, slowly, so people can absorb this a little bit. And that's your camera.
That's
right
mine. Okay. What I'm trying to say is that if you go now and bomb places like Iraq and Afghanistan, there will be only more terrorists, quote unquote. There will be only more people who will be willing to sacrifice their lives to, you know, get some kind of the feeling of justice. To, you know, it's, that will be an act of creating more reactionary Muslim people who will regard the United States as an evil force, and they will be very much willing to sacrifice their lives to kill other Americans, to bomb other cities in America, to destroy all these other constructions and buildings and towers in other parts of America. That's not a smart thing to do. That is not a smart thing to
do. So what is the smart thing?
Smart thing is that, you know, there is no short-term solution to this problem. In the long term, though, I believe America, United States government, has to change its foreign policy imperatives, mm-hmm. their strategies, their targets, their aims in the Middle East, you know, and they should be less willing to identify with the interests of Israel, or places like, you know, other regressive, other, you know, undemocratic countries in the Middle East. That's the long-term cause, and I'm not a political scientist, and I can't tell that. I can't tell the United States government or anybody else, if United States does this, everything will be fine and dandy. There is no way to solve this problem in those short-term.
No simplistic way.
Right. The long-term, you know, remedy is to stop having, you know, enemies on the part of the United States. You know, just if you go and bomb somewhere, people of that place, residents of that place will be your enemies. And that's what happened, really. And another thing that's very interesting is that, you know, once in this country there was a strong, powerful, and very proud opposition to United States' involvement in Vietnam. There is no such moment in the United States in regards to the United States involvement in the Middle East. There is no popular moment, a group of people, vocal people, who construct some kind of opposition to United States foreign policies here. You know, and until the time that a similar kind of opposition movement within the boundaries of United States is generated, is created, it will be very difficult for the people of the Middle East to sympathize with the deaths of American people, because they feel that, you know, American people are supporting their government. And for that reason, they are as evil as American government is. So I think that government, the United States government, has to change its policy imperatives immediately.
I hope they see that.
Yeah.
As I told you as we came here, I wrote three letters to our Congress people and asked them to change the policies of our country. I have no idea whether.
Yeah.
They will understand what I'm saying or not. It's a complicated situation.
It is very much so. It is very much so. Yeah, it's just people like me, people like you, on the other hand, can emphasize the fact that, you know, there are different, as I've been telling so far, there are different parts, different faces of Islam. And Islam itself is not one, you know, total monolithic structure, total monolithic culture. And we have to be aware of the fact that, you know, there are other people within Islamic countries other than those people who are cheering on televisions. They're sincerely upset about what happened.
Tell us a little bit about the difference between the Shiite, mm-hmm. and the Sunni. Because I understand Sunni is the majority of Islam.
Yes, yes. Majority of the Shiite population in the Middle East live in Iran, of course, and southern part of Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
And after the Gulf War, United States supported the rebellion by the Shiite Iraqis against Saddam, but that was unsuccessful. And many Shia Iraqis were killed by Saddam. And the main difference between the Sunni Muslims, Sunni population of the Middle East, and the Shia is that it's ancient. It happened. That divergence emerged in the 7th and 8th centuries.
7th and 8th?
Right.
That's a long time ago.
It is. It is very long time ago. And it was on succession to Prophet Muhammad, who was going to succeed Muhammad. And the Shiites believed that the cousin and son-in-law of Muhammad, a guy called Ali, had to, you know, succeed him because he was the most eligible person according to them. The Sunni majority believed that another person, another companion of Muhammad, a guy called Abu Bakr, was to follow him. That's a trivial issue. But the distinction between them is that they have a different notion of leadership. Mm-hmm. According to you know, traditional understanding, Sunni understanding of leadership, the Islamic leader, the leader of the Islamic community, has to be someone chosen by the community himself.
Mm-hmm.
According to Shiite traditions, the leader is someone who is from the lineage of, from the line of Prophet himself, Prophet and through his daughter Fatima.
Like the bloodline of
exactly,
the king.
Exactly. And the Shiites attribute some mystical and divine character to their leaders, used to, not in the modern period, but that was the essential traditional understanding of leadership in Shia Islam. Hmm. Muslims do not necessarily, you know, attribute those divine characteristics to their leaders. But all through the history, Shiites have been always in minority and in weaker position. The most important Shia state in Islamic history is a state called Safavids, who were major opponents of Ottoman Empire, who represent Ottomans represent the interests of Sunni Islam. And now today, Iran is the major Shia power, the place in which a Shia interpretation of Islam is in power and dominating the country. And in other parts of the Middle East, although there are Shia minorities, they're all minorities. They are under the control of the Sunni governments. Even in Turkey, there are some Shia people, although they never play an important part in the political situation. Like, you know, this is the same situation in Iraq. In Iraq, they tried to establish a Shia government, but as I was saying, it was defeated by the forces of Saddam.
The Shiites tend to be more interested in military power?
No, not necessarily. And even if they do, in different times in their history, that wasn't because of their religious teachings. That was, that was because of the context, historical context, times and conditions in which they were living. It's not true. And many people, many scholars, not myself, consider the existing governmental situation structure in Iran as a modernized version of the most modernized version of Islamic governance in you can find in the Middle East.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This might be accurate or inaccurate. I'm not going to talk about this. But you know, there are opinions about that.
Let me interrupt us for a moment and just tell our viewers again, because I have learned that people channel surf and they mm-hmm. don't sit down and watch a program for an hour. And so some people may not know who you are or who I am. And this is a program called Struggles of the Spirit. And I'm the host and the program director, Lee Udell, and I have a guest on here today, Bogac Ergene, and he's a PhD and professor at the University of Vermont in Mideast history?
Middle East and Islam.
Middle East and Islam.
Right.
And so he's consented to come and talk with us today about his specialty and about the current events that have been going on in our lives since September 11. So if you find some of the things that you're hearing interesting, helpful, infuriating, whatever, please get in touch with us through the studio, call or write the Adelphia Cable studio, and we will respond to your communication. So please be in touch. We would appreciate hearing from you. So, now where are we now? I guess we have 20 minutes, something like that.
Yeah.
Do you want to continue in the vein we're talking, or do you want to shift a little bit?
Whatever you want me to talk about.
Well, I guess, as we were chatting beforehand, I mean, I like everything we've been saying, and the emphasis, but for you to share a little bit about the history of Islam and of what would be the term? Not necessarily Islamic people, but
Muslim people.
Okay.
Right. And Middle East people. Yeah.
And as we were talking before we were on the air, I long before the 11th of September, I had become aware of Ibn Battuta, who was something like Marco Polo,
right?
Who roughly the same time, I think it was 1323.
Something like that, yes.
1323.
Yes. 14th century, yes.
He was born, I think, in Tunisia.
Yeah.
In North Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And he was well educated, and he decided he would go to China, but not go quickly like Marco Polo. His interest was more to live with the people,
mm-hmm.
and to teach, to work with individuals, enter into the culture of the world and of the Muslim religion. And I was amazed because as I read, I discovered that the Muslim world was way ahead of the Western world in Europe. I mean, they were universities and colleges all over the place.
Right.
And not only that, they had a great commerce in the Indian Ocean. They were trading with India and Africa and the whole eastern coast of Africa, right down to the Cape of Good Hope.
Right.
And we had this Westerner called Vasco da Gama, who I remember learning about, who was daring and set out to explore the Atlantic Ocean along the coast of Africa and got all the way down, and I guess to the Cape of Good Hope. And the way, at least the way it was presented to me, was that, you know, this was a daring adventurer, and here the whole life on the other side of the continent was of the Muslim people was just going on all the time. Like, you know, there was nothing daring about it. It was just earning a living, being a good merchant, setting up trading posts all along the coast,
mm-hmm.
and Ibn Battuta went on to. He went to the holy places in Cairo and
right.
Mecca and
Medina, right?
And then he went on all the way to India, and was even an official, a judge in India. And it was a very hospitable world in some ways. And he was not attacked by robbers, and
right.
he was honored, welcomed into people's homes. it's the way that I'd like the world to be. And
yes.
So what happened that, so that...
Well, that process was probably more hostile and more difficult, more daring for Vasco da Gama than it was for Ibn Battuta, in a sense that all the places that Ibn Battuta was going, you know, people, actually it was part of one unified world. Everybody, in everywhere.
The Muslim world.
The Muslim world, and the people living in those parts of the world, in those parts of the Middle East and Asia, Southeast Asia and North Africa, they were all speaking the same language. That's why he didn't have any kind, and sharing same kind of values and culture, the aspects of culture, that's why he didn't have any kind of trouble.
It was Arabic.
Arabic, right, and he did not encounter any kind of trouble in interacting with them, and that's why, as you mentioned, you know, he could act as a judge in a place that he did not live before until that time.
Thousands and thousands of miles
away, and that shows that in the 14th century how unified the Muslim world was, in a sense, what kind of interaction existed between different parts of the Muslim world. You know, it's just many people, especially in the West, again, do not know that there existed a place other than Europe in 14th
yeah,
centuries and
don't.
Earlier.
They're ignorant.
The only thing that they know about is all this is about crusades. And crusades are regarded as, you know, a trip to the land of the barbarians, in a sense. And although the Muslims consider crusades themselves as barbarians.
Well, my guest on the program a few weeks ago, he's a cultural geographer.
Uh-huh.
He said that the Muslims thought that the Christian crusaders were nuts because they were attacking, murdering, and stealing from each other.
They did think that way. And they were horrified by the fact that when crusaders, some of them at least, you know, were able to capture Jerusalem, they killed the Christians who were living in Jerusalem. Because they didn't consider that the Oriental kind of Christianity is something, you know, related to the kind of belief system that they had.
And
they killed Jews in Jerusalem. And that's why many Jews in the Middle East sided with the Muslims in their struggle against Christians during the time of Christianity, during the time of the Crusades. That's a very interesting story, actually, you know, just, but for Muslims knew that, you know, just the part of the world that they were living at that time was the most civilized place at that time, according to the standards of that time, you know, on the world. And they were horrified about the idea that, you know, one of them or, you know, two of them or merchants, Muslim merchants, will travel to the West. They will be, because they were under the impression, rightfully so, that, you know, during those times, Europe was a wild place to go. You know, their life will be threatened probably. But as you mentioned, Ibn Battuta was able to make all these travels precisely because they shared the same culture and language with the people who of those places who visited.
And he was even given married on the way.
That's true. He made a couple of, he got into a couple of marriages and he wasn't happy with all of them. But
no.
That's another story.
That's another story.
So he's an incredible persona. It's just he was very knowledgeable in law. He practiced as a judge, as you mentioned, in a place like India. Although that raises another issue, you know, we mentioned this, we talked about this before the program, you know, not all these people, the native people of all these places that he visited were Muslims. They did not all knew Arabic. And, you know, which means that, you know, different people, different cultures were under Muslim rulers.
Mm-hmm.
And they had their own grievances. We should not really idealize and force, you know, the Muslim world in a sense. That's a kind of danger. That's kind of, you know, not seeing what really the real grievances of the people living there.
The same way that we might do today, idealizing the American
exactly.
way.
Right. For example, although we mentioned people, the Christians of Middle East fought, you know, just did not like the Christians of West Europe. But at the same time, they believed that, and for some rightful reasons, the Muslim rulers of the Middle East were not very nice to them, and for specific reasons. And but that's, you know, that may be, although that's not a nice thing, that's not a thing that, you know, we would like to have in an idealized world. You know, it's probably natural too.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably natural too. And but absolutely right. Just, you know, Northern Africa, Middle East, Arabian Peninsula, Iran, Anatolia, and India, Southeast Asia, specific part of Southeast Asia, and parts of Inner Asia all constituted one, relatively speaking, unified world, who were able to, you know, just people from these parts of the world, different parts of within this world, were able to come together, interact with each other, exchange communities, and share a specific part of their culture. Yeah. And pilgrimage, for example, is another issue which enhanced that interaction.
The pilgrimage to Mecca.
It's one of the five pillars of, considered as one of the five pillars of Islam, five very important acts of worship in Islam. It's a if you have financial means to it, to do that, to perform pilgrimage, you are obligated to go Mecca once in your lifetime. And, you know, make circumambulations against Kaaba and other kind of specific.
What is it called when you make that pilgrimage to Mecca?
It's Hajj in Arabic.
Hajj.
And if you, as someone who participates in that pilgrimage, you will be someone haji, someone who's performed and finished haji. And it's a, it generates social status. It promotes your social status in the community. And it's very important from social, cultural, and economic terms, because as it's the obligated worship, it's something that's expected from you to do as a Muslim. Even if you are living in India, or Tunisia, Algeria, or Anatolia, or in the Balkans, you have to go and visit the Arabian Peninsula. And through that way, you know, your knowledge of other people, other Muslims, and other parts within the Muslim world will increase. You will learn more about other people, your parts of your community. Because in Islamic terms, although you might have different different languages, different cultures, as someone, for example, living in Anatolia, in comparison to someone living in Mecca or Egypt, in religious terms, you are part of the same community, and you are obligated to know about, learn about the other members of your community. For that reason, pilgrimage to Mecca is very, very important in terms of creating that identity of us, identity of, you know, the feeling that you are part of one community, one Islamic community. And that feeling existed until very late in our history, until 20th century. We find, for example, the Muslims of Pakistan collecting money among each, you know, themselves, and sending this money to Ottoman Empire in 20th century, because they considered the Ottoman Empire was fighting against European powers. Although Pakistanis did not live under the, you know, under the rule of Ottoman Empire, they helped the Ottoman Sultan and Ottoman government, because they felt that they were supposed to, they were obligated to do so, because Ottoman Sultan represented Islam to, you know, to European powers, to Christian powers in a sense. And to a certain extent, that feeling still, you know, exists in different parts of the Muslim world. You know, it's just people from very different countries will feel that they are close to each other, because, you know, they are part of the same community, they share same understanding of religion. Although nowadays, you know, they wouldn't probably speak the same language as it used to be in the earlier times. But there is this feeling of us, in a sense, which could be bad and which could be good. It was good for Ibn Battuta, because, you know, he was able to go and, you know, be, other people were very hospitable to him, and he, you know, he was able to travel without being harmed. But at the same time, you know, it's bad in a sense that every sense of feeling, every sense of, you know, us isolates other people in this 20th century, for example. When there are Muslims living in this country, some of them feel that, you know, Christians are not part of their community, which is a wrong, which is a bad thing to do on their part, to feel on their part. Yeah, it's
something that I learned from a guest I had on television here sometime before. He works in business in the Burlington area, and he's a Sunni Muslim. And he told me that he and others routinely pray five times a day.
They do, yeah.
They get down on the floor, on a rug, and do that. Now, I can tell you, you know, frankly, Christians are supposed to pray, at least I'm Episcopalian, I'm familiar with their ways of worship, and Roman Catholic or Greek Orthodox, Russian Orthodox, they're supposed to pray, you know, maybe two times a day, at least morning and night, not five, unless you're a monk. The monk then prays seven times a day. Right. But I mean, the great majority don't. They just don't.
Right.
So to hear that there are a large number of Muslims who
they do
pray five times a day, I'm impressed.
Are you? Okay. You will be impressed if I tell you the story of prayer. It's a, you know, it's a story. It's not a story. It's a legend, actually, which is acknowledged by religious authorities as authentic, being authentic. Muhammad, apparently, according to this religious story, legend, which is considered as authentic, as true, was one night taken by Angel Gabriel to Jerusalem and taken to the level of God. And at that level, God ordered him to, you know, to pray 50 times a day, actually.
50?
And And on his way back from the level of God, he encountered Moses. Moses is considered one of the important prophetic figures in Islam too. He's considered as a real prophet. Mm-hmm. And Moses told him that it's too much. Go up there to the level of God and ask him to reduce the number, to make it less. And God was, took a pity on him, I guess, and his people, and made it five. And on the way back, prophet again encountered Moses. He said, five is all right, you can do it. They indeed do. They indeed try to, not all of them could do that, because you will have to wake up in the middle of the night, and you will have to wake up again second time before the sun dawns, and you have to pray. My grandmother does that, for example. It's a very devout Muslim.
How long would she pray each time?
Oh, it's not that long. It depends on the time of the day that he's praying. It's between 10 to 15 minutes. And during night time it's kind of shorter, because people want to go back to their sleep. And I said, but it is. Actually, prayer is one of the most important worships, the pillars. I was mentioning the pillars, and pilgrimage is one.
That's
of them.
That's why I was thinking of it.
And prayer is another one. And what's very important about prayer is that purification, ablution is essential part of it. Each and every time you begin praying, you have to clean your hands.
Wash your hands.
And to the elbows and your feet and your face, and wipe your earlobes and forehead. And it's, many people believe that it's this enhances the sense of purity, this cleanliness. And it's that's why praying and ablutions are a sense of civility in Islamic world. If you do that, you are considered as a noble person, as a civil person. You are clean.
Like if I were a guest in your home, you would invite me to go and wash my hands?
I wouldn't do that, but my parents would, because myself, I kind of do. I'm a follower of different kind of...
You're more modern.
I am, yeah. But my grandfather and grandmother would do that. And other Muslims will do that. That's the first sign of hospitality towards guests. Because, they will believe that you would want to feel clean and pure in their own house. Well, it's not because they will be offended if you don't wash your hands, but they will think that you will need to clean your hands, in a sense. They will do that.
Well, my doctor friends say that's the most that is most important,
right.
Washing your hands. And and the Japanese, as you probably know, will give you hot, moist towels, oshibori, which is very pleasant to.
Very relaxing too.
Very relaxing. Yeah.
Right, and
different culture, different religion, but quite nice.
It is. But in different parts of Islamic world, when water is scarce phenomena, and you can perform those ablutions before the prayer by.
Our time is up.
All right.
When I hear the music, I know that. So thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
I'd like to be here talking with you another hour at least.
Yeah.
We've been here talking today with Dr. Bogac Ergene. He's a professor of history at the University of Vermont, and we're glad you're here. And
thanks for having me.
We hope we can make you a Vermonter as well.
Thank you. Thank you.
Really.
Thank you.
I looked at my...